Well, welcome to another Auto Central show, ladies and gentlemen. Your number one South African automotive podcast powered by Auto Trader. And I'm your show host, George Meany, and I have in the studio with me Wandile Sishi as usual. How's it, Wandy?
Hey, George, how's it going? Glad to be here. Another week, another podcast. Let's do it.
Let's do it. So just a reminder for those who don't listen on the day that we air, which is Monday at 9 a.m. on cliffcentral.com. If you want to join us anytime, you can subscribe to the podcast and you can use your favorite player. You can either get us or find us on YouTube at Auto Trader SA or on any of the podcast platforms that are around, which is iTunes, Spotify. What else is there?
Iono, pretty much any, you can find us anywhere.
Cliffcentral.com, YouTube, the works. We're hopefully everywhere. So in today's show, which is entitled Year Today, Gone Tomorrow, and it's all around hybrids. Hybrids are supposed to be the knight in shining armor for the world, and a little bit of a bridge in my mind between EVs and ICE vehicles. And what do you think, Wandy? Is hybrids a bit of a thing of the past?
Well, you know, I'm kind of on the fence about it because on the one end, I think a lot of people believe that hybrids are the bridge, right? They're the middle point between these combustion engines versus the electric, the electric drivetrain.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it does something that is completely different. I think it has a very unique positioning. It's not really the middle point. It's completely different point.
Yeah.
In the sense that I think, you know, manufacturers have become really, really creative with how they use an electric drivetrain as almost like this energy recovery system or this fuel-efficient assistance to the engine instead of this thing which is supposed to be combustion and electric. Now, I think the two have to work together for it to be this great solution.
Well, I mean, I suppose hybrid is neither electric nor is it petrol. It's both.
It's both. Yeah.
It's both. You know, I personally, hybrids have a place, and I suppose they have a place where there's no charging infrastructure or no EV charging infrastructure. But I don't think they have a place long term. In my mind, they bridge the gap because, you know, you've got a petrol engine. Plus, you've got an electric motor. Plus, you've got batteries.
Yeah.
So, you've got everything inside this car. More to go wrong?
Well, you see, that's the thing. Like, it's basically this vehicle that's going to be half illegal in a few years, right? So, like, you invest all this
half
money.
Half illegal. I like that. Half illegal.
You invest it's like kind all of this being pregnant. Yeah, well, in certain states in America, yeah. It's weird. It's a weird thing that these OEMs are investing so much money in something that, you know, might be completely outlawed in a few years. But then I thought about it. Why would you buy a hybrid car? Like, who is actually buying these vehicles? You know, I wouldn't say it's somebody who's completely, like, you know, I'm trying to be super green.
Yeah.
At the same time,
you're half green.
Half green, exactly, yeah. Or somebody who's like, you know what, I want performance, and I, you know, I'm a true car lover.
Yeah.
Screw the electric engine. I think it's somebody completely different. I think it's someone who is looking for less or more efficiency, but at the same time, power. So it's a different. I can't profile. I don't know a single person who owns a hybrid. I don't know what they look like. I only know the celebrities who did it when it just came out.
Well, the Prius, right? 1997, the Prius. So I think the Prius looks like a lunchbox.
I think it looks terrible as well. But I mean, it's starting to look a lot better.
The Prius?
Yeah, I think the people have this thought of the 1997 Prius, but hybrids have come a long way. You know, there's Lexus.
Well, there's the Volvo.
And Lexus.
And Lexus.
BMW. There's a few C-Class. There's a few in South Africa. They are popular for some reason, but I don't know a single person that actually owns.
Well, I know two or three people that own hybrids. I mean, I think they have a place in the world, but I don't think they have a place in the long term future of the world because, like you say, it's half green, half not. At the moment, there's 132 hybrids on Auto Trader out of 64,000 cars. So the fact that it's been around since 1997, 132 should tell you something. You know, I don't know if this hybrid world is really for South Africa. You know, and the BMW i8. Is a hybrid.
Exactly.
And it's one of the sexiest cars on the road today.
Well, I think price points plays a huge, you know, talking point. And in the hybrids. You know, the cheapest electric vehicle is what? Just under 700K.
Yeah.
Cheapest hybrid is a little under 400,000 rand.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you're going to be buying this cheap hybrid, why not just go fully electric or just fully ICE? Because I feel like you're not really getting that much out of it.
You're kind of pregnant.
You exactly, yeah. So it's I think in South Africa it's just a bit strange. We didn't really pick it up as much as some of the countries in the world, for various reasons. And you know, it will be interesting to see how long they last in South Africa. You know, Toyota just invested 2.3 billion on a plant recently.
Is that for electric vehicles? No,
purely for hybrid, right?
Yeah, exactly. So Toyota's thinking differently.
They are. I did read that Lexus, for instance, 46% of all of their sales in South Africa are hybrid vehicles. And Toyota owning them, it kind of makes sense for them.
Yeah.
But for the country and the near future, I'm still on the fence of, is this drivetrain actually dying or not? And what's the point of it?
Yeah. Well, I mean, the top 10 most searched for hybrids on autotrader.co.za. Number one is the Porsche 918.
No surprise there. Very aspirational.
Yeah.
It costs like 40 million rand, but, you know.
40 million rand.
But, you know, I mean, I've looked at the car countless times.
Yeah.
It's a dream. And once again, hybrid makes sense for that car.
Yeah.
Because it serves as this energy reduction system that's just going to give you this insane amount of boost.
Yes.
So it makes sense.
Well, aren't Formula One cars hybrid?
They are. The current era of Formula One cars are hybrid, yeah. It makes sense when you're trying to get a lot from a little.
A little, yeah. So you can put a little 1,000cc motor inside an electric car, and you've got the best of both worlds. BMW i8, number 2, ranked out of 10. And then the Mercedes-Benz S-Class Hybrid.
Yeah. What a car.
I mean, I think there's quite a few of those on the road, but you don't see. They don't make a big deal of it being hybrid on the outside of the car.
They don't. I don't think many OEMs actually make a big deal out of their hybrid, except the i8s. I mean, they
yeah. Well, you can see an i8 looks like a Tron car.
Yeah, you're like, what is it? Is it electric? Is it quick?
When they first came out, and electric cars weren't the thing.
Yeah.
At the time, I thought it was an electric car.
Me too.
It wasn't.
Yeah.
It wasn't.
I've actually driven it and mixed feelings. You know, really? I love BMW, but I have really mixed feelings about it because I've driven.
Is it quick?
It's
quickish.
Quickish, yeah.
Okay.
I think it's old. It's outdated.
Yeah.
But yeah, it has its special place.
Then the Lexus RX 450 you spoke about earlier, SE Hybrid, which is in the fifth place. And then the Toyota Yaris Hybrid, BMW 3 Series Active Hybrid, Lexus CT200H Hybrid, and then the Toyota Auris Hybrid, and then 10th place, Toyota Prius. So, although Toyota Prius has been around probably the longest, it only features 10th on the list.
Yeah, I think I remember when you did an interview and we were actually looking at Prius searches and sold data for it, and people just don't want it anymore, to be honest. But I do believe they're actually making a new one that's coming out soon. So we'll see if it gains its popularity again.
Well, like you mentioned earlier, Toyota has just invested 2.5 billion rand as part of Toyota's broader strategy, and more than 4 billion rands worth of investment into the local auto industry over the next few years. So Andrew Kirby says that 36% of Lexus vehicles sold in South Africa are hybrids. You said this earlier as well.
Yeah. So it makes sense for Toyota to do this, but I don't know about the rest.
Well, that's Lexus. I mean, I think that number drops quite significantly when you put everything else in the pot, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
So Toyota's plan is in line with tectonic shifts in the economies towards greener industries. Yeah, I don't know. I think it might be a bit half pregnant, a hybrid, that is.
I mean, they know what they're doing, right? They've done some...
No, I'm not talking about Toyota. I'm talking about a hybrid vehicle as a class of car.
If I had to put it down on the table now, on the record, so the world knows, I honestly
don't think
it's going to last much longer.
Yeah.
I think now it has its place, but not in the long term. not in the next 20 years.
We have to go all electric, right?
Yeah.
We have to go all electric.
It's the way of the future. It's the only thing that makes sense.
Unless something comes around and says, okay, well, you know, we're gonna forego electric because there's some sort of, you know, photon,
yeah,
like propulsion like an Iron system Man or, yeah, of, you know. But I don't see that on the horizon either.
No. I think it's
unless we employ jet
hybrid man. Is dying. Yeah. But if you own a hybrid, I don't think you should be worried. We're talking about 20 years from now or something. So, Yeah, it's a weird one.
It is a weird one. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if there's anything to write home about. On these hybrids, to be honest, they had their day.
They had their day,
and maybe they'll have their day in the future again. But
I can't see how. I just can't see how. But it's we'll see. Yeah.
We'll see. I don't know, but nonetheless, we're going to end the discussion around hybrids at that point, and we're going to bring none other than Chad Lückhoff into the studio via Zoom, and we're going to be speaking to Chad today about the Ford EcoSport, and sometimes featured in the top 10 most searched for cars in South Africa on Auto Trader. This new EcoSport, is it fitting of its popularity? Chad, how's it?
Hi guys, how are we doing?
Good. We were talking about hybrids a little bit earlier on, and we moved to the Ford EcoSport. EcoSport might just kind of sound like a hybrid, but we know it's not, right?
No, it's not a hybrid. Locally, we don't have any sort of hybrid offerings in that model. Many of them will pronounce it EcoSport, believe it or not.
EcoSport.
Less on the Eco and more on the sort of EcoSport, despite the fact that there's no H in the name.
Why is it EcoSport? Why is it not EcoSport? What's the?
I have no idea. Your guess is as good as mine.
Well, I've actually never heard that. It's the first time I'm hearing that. So, my bad.
So first question, Chad: is the EcoSport a true SUV, or is it trying to be an SUV?
No. It really is a compact. It's more crossover, that's a bit of an anomaly on its own, because a crossover can be just about anything.
Yeah.
By definition, it can be a crossover, an amphibious vehicle is a crossover. So,
that's true.
this is more taking a compact hatchback, the likes of a Fiesta. So think of it around Fiesta size, and just giving you some SUV-like properties. Okay. So you've got what they call a command driving position. Yeah. That's a little more bus driver-like, if you'd like to determine it like that. So less laying down in the vehicle and a little more sitting more upright, gives you a clearer view of the road. You are sitting a little higher. You're also going to get a little slightly increased ground clearance. And that's great if you do lead a bit of an active lifestyle. You hit a dirt road every now and then, or you just want a pavement hop. But from a safety aspect, it helps as well, because a slightly better view of the road allows you to anticipate dangers. Yeah. That much easier.
Well, when you say bus driver type style, you make me think of the Toyota, what is that thing called? Very upright, Breton-like vehicle.
Land Cruiser
Pro. No. It's they're used for Uber vehicles a lot. Uber X. What is that thing called now, man?
The Corolla.
No, not the Corolla.
Like an NV style.
Yeah,
NV200 or an NV350.
The almost like a Breton where the bus steering wheel is almost facing down.
As such, EcoSport just sort of combines that. You've still got car-like driving abilities. It doesn't feel too foreign from those that are, progressing or graduating, if you can put it that way, from a compact little hatchback, whether it's a compact VW, a compact Ford, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It's still going to drive and handle roughly the same, but it's just going to provide a little more space and slightly more raised driving position, raised drive height, ride height. It's just a little more SUV-like, but not quite SUV.
Toyota Avante, that's what I was thinking of, Toyota Avante.
Oh, yes. Avante, yeah.
It's a little bit
Avanza.
I mean the
Avanza, that's the right word.
Avanza or the Rush.
Did I get Avante wrong? Yes, I did. Avanza, yes, Avanza.
Well, the Toyota Avante was a model, but it was a Corolla-based model
back then. Okay, there we go. That's why we've got Chad as the expert.
As the expert, yeah.
On these things, because he remembers everything. He's got a memory like an elephant.
Yeah.
I wish.
So what's the interior like, Chad? I mean, I've driven the Ford Fiesta you know, a number of times. And the Ford EcoSport, as you say, is a bit of a, you know, a pavement climber. Is it the same as the Ford Fiesta inside? What is the, is it luxurious?
Very similar. So the concerns here are around the trim levels. And I've encountered this before, and I've encountered this on a Fiesta level as well. So they start with the ambient trim level, which is this new model. It is an ambient with an automatic gearbox, and that's pretty much its USP right now. But you get the ambient, you get the trend, and you get the titanium. And the ambient models are, well, it's clear to see that there have been some cost savings and cost cuttings in the process, where they've sort of trimmed back on some of the interior accoutrements and the tech in order to just pass those savings on to the customer. And unfortunately, that's probably the weakest spot of this one, is just in the overall fit and finish. So I'm led to believe that this ambient model is produced in India and possibly doesn't have the same sort of quality control that Ford would be wanting. So I just noticed a couple of nasty panel gaps, some flashing from the moldings, and that anybody that knows the process of injection molding will understand what flashing is. Yeah. Some flashing that hasn't been cleared off, or, you know, finished off in a nice way. So sort of sharpish edges that can snag things. And when I actually went to go and open the bonnet to go and take a look under the hood, a panel came off in my hand. So a little, yeah, a little less than ideal. And that was not a great way to start my tenure with the vehicle.
Yeah.
But after a while, I would like to say that it's a little more rugged than some of the leather, full leather trims and suede trimmings and that sort of stuff. So if you are looking to be a little more rough and tumble, then yeah, the ambient's got that sort of hose down, wipe off sort of appeal to it.
Oh, wow.
Not that I would recommend doing that, but it is just going to be a little more hardy. So yes, those with younger kids, messy ice creams, chocolates, that sort of stuff. Vomit. Yeah, this is going to be the one, you know, that you gravitate a little
more. It's widely popular, right? And you're saying these things, but
it is,
it's because it's priced right. Like, it's priced really, really right. What is the price, Chad?
306,700 rand.
Okay, so you're square in the middle of the crossovers.
Yeah, it's not. I don't want to say that it's the cheapest offering. Yes, there are cheaper out there, but it is the cheapest offering in the segment with an automatic gearbox. Like I said, that's one of those USPs. Yeah. The next model up is nearly 20k more expensive in the form of the Hyundai Venue 1.1 liter turbo auto. Mm. So it's definitely one of the cheaper versions out there. It's not the cheapest, but I think it hits a nice sweet spot there. And then it's also worth noting that, listen, for that price, you actually can't beat it in terms of safety. It has probably the best in market or in segment safety there.
Oh, wow.
So, I mean, they've got a substantial, I mean, it's worth, just get the numbers here, 6 airbags, where many of the others have only got 4 airbags.
Okay.
And there's a lot of standard safety equipment in it, even in this ambient trim level, that you're not going to get in some of the others. So that's definitely another check in the pros box.
And the kinds of people that you see driving the EcoSport, I mean, what would that kind of person be?
I identify the target market as the young family. I would definitely say those that are looking to upgrade from the hatchback. They've been running around in Polos, Fiestas, Figas, something of the sorts, and now it's just time that they need a little bit of packing space. And yeah, packing space is generous. A really, really great packing space. I think it has, stand on a correction, 333 liters.
Wow.
Of boot space, which for a vehicle of this size, and it really is nice and compact, is generous. And of course, you fold the seats down, you're going to get 705 liters. So,
what is the average? What is the average boot of a you know, let's say a Fiesta? What is the average boot?
Well, I think you're sitting around the 240 mark. Okay, I'd have to check. I'm just up
considerably
of the head. Yeah.
So considerably more.
Yeah, it's really generous. So those that are looking to pack in prams, you know, school bags, kit bags, that type of thing, you know, you need to...
And be safe.
Caught the carry cot around, something of the sorts. It's definitely going to be one of those. And if you are starting a family, or you have a young family, safety is going to be on your priority.
Yeah.
Ease of use. And I mean, that's now where the EcoSport sort of just really comes into its own, providing you a little more safety on the road and just... the impression of safety as well, by being able to see over some of the other traffic.
And power output, and you know, a general kind of zippiness, is it well enough powered for its body?
It's adequately powered. It's definitely not the most powerful out there. And any naturally aspirated engine is going to suffer a little bit up here at the reef. And it's something that I've mentioned in the past as well, that the emission of a turbocharger just makes it feel a bit of the pinch. And as such, with the automatic gearbox, it tends to rev out a little bit, or you really need to just, you know, floor it to pass in that. But it has the trade-off where it's actually pretty economical for a naturally aspirated vehicle. So, I mean, the figures there, it says that it makes 91 kilowatts and 150 newton meters. It doesn't sound like much.
Yeah.
And it will probably feel the pinch when you load it up with, let's say, four adults. But if you're carting the kids around, or you're just, you know, you're on your own, really more than adequate for daily driving in that.
Well, let's get to the, you know, auto trader, professional journalist rank. What would you rank this car out of 10, Chad? A four. There we have it.
A four
out of 10.
That is so harsh. That's the harshest thing I've ever heard. I think it's like...
I changed my mind because I just had to sit there and I had to be honest. It's not the vehicle for me.
Okay,
plain and simple. It doesn't really fit into my lifestyle. And if I was spending that money, I would possibly spend it somewhere else. But that's mainly because I don't mind driving a manual. Yeah. Those that really have to have the auto, I have to concede, yeah, it's a good call for that. I couldn't look past some of the misprogrammings of the gearbox, especially, like I say, driving up here at altitude.
Yeah.
And just that interior fit and finish would drive me nutty. When I'm buying a new vehicle, I want the panels to fit properly. I don't want things to come off in my hand.
Well.
But then I will give it because, I mean, on a somewhat extended, Ford claims 6.9 liters per 100 in terms of the fuel consumption. Let me just get this out there. I got it down to under that on the open road.
That's unheard of, right? I mean, usually they overstate the fuel consumption.
That's insane.
Absolutely. And admittedly, this is combined cycle, so it deals with stop-start and that. So open road is definitely going to be lower. But the fact that they were sort of on the money there, and then when I started driving at stop-start, I was getting mid-sevens from a naturally aspirated petrol engine. I mean, that's just another check in the win box. So yes, it is going to suit some customers out there and consumers out there that are looking for this type of vehicle, auto gearbox safety, et cetera, et cetera. For me, you know, I would go with something like a Renault Duster and just live with rowing my own cogs.
Okay. That's very interesting. Well, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. The Ford EcoSport Ambient Auto 1.5, or EcoSport, whichever way you want to say it. And our very own Chad Lückhoff, a very experienced journalist in South Africa. And go and check out his videos. He makes some of the best videos that South Africa has ever seen. Gives the Ford EcoSport a 4 out of 10. And Wendy, unfortunately, you can't have all cars above 8 out of 10, China.
Yeah, look, I'm an expert, right? I don't view cars from your point of view. I view from just, do I like it? Is the price right? Does it get me to A to B when I'm ranking vehicles, you know? So
exactly.
I think on that I would rank it a bit higher, but you know, you looking at everything that a consumer will actually have to consider. So
well, eventually, that's why we've got to take Chad's opinion, right? Because eventually when you've had the car for like 12 months, you're gonna say, Chad was right. Chad was right.
Exactly.
Well, there you have it, Chad. And Chad, thank you very much for joining, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you, guys. Always a pleasure.
Ciao.
Take care.
What do you think? Would you buy one?
Well, after the four, I'm on the fence about it because you raised some really good points that I think a consumer needs to consider. But once again, yeah, I mean, it's wildly popular for a reason. I think a lot of people are happy with what it does provide you.
Yeah.
So I personally would. I wouldn't take it off my list of potentials. Yeah.
Well, in terms of crossover, I've got a very high amount of respect for another crossover, the Fiat 500X.
Oh yeah.
The Fiat 500X I think is a very capable car, and every time I meet a crossover, I compare it to the Fiat 500X now, you know, is. It's a nice car. So there are 943 Ford EcoSport 1.5 ambient autos on Autotrader today. So if you're looking for a nearly new, or even a new Ford EcoSport 1.5 ambient, go and check out autotrader.co.za. Well, some consumers have asked questions, right?
Every week.
Every week.
We get a fresh bunch of really good questions, sometimes really weird questions, but We have some good ones this
week. Stuff. So everyday people, send Auto Trader some motoring related questions on Ask Auto Trader, and ask any kind of question you want and we will attempt to answer it. So some of the burning questions were, go for it, Wendy.
Okay, so the first question comes from Tisetso, and she asked, I've read prior that the direction you park on an incline has an adverse effect on your fuel. So this is, if you park in a certain direction, it might increase your fuel consumption. Can you please clarify, is this is this true?
I don't think so. I think the only instance where parking in any sort of incline, decline, sidecline is going to have an effect on your fuel consumption is if you have a leak in your petrol tank.
Yeah, because it's bizarre that that would happen.
Don't see it happen.
Where's the fuel going?
If don't know who told you that.
Yeah, yeah. They're playing a prank on this person,
I reckon. Tisetso, I think somebody been playing a prank on you, but this just doesn't sound right unless your fuel tank has a leak.
Yeah.
You know, park upside down, maybe, you know, the petrol will leak out.
Yeah. I've actually never heard this before, so yeah. I'm pretty convinced that this was like some guy who was like, listen, I'm working on your car and I think you need a new something. I'll fix it for you. And now, yeah, she almost got duped because that's just nonsense. Well,
Tisetso, don't listen to the person who is trying to dupe you. This is not true. The car doesn't care which direction you're parked in. Fuel consumption is going to be about, you know, how you drive the car rather than where you park or how you park the car. And also, that's a good point, actually. You know, when you're parking the car, you've got zero fuel consumption.
Yeah, I was about to say, how would it impact?
Yeah. I mean, fuel does evaporate slowly, but it's nothing to really concern yourself about. And question number two, Wendy.
Question number two is, how do hybrid cars work and are they reliable? It's a very common question that we get asked. And we just spoke about hybrids. So can you clarify for us, George?
Well, the term hybrid implies that a car is propelled by a mixture of both a combustion engine and electric power, both of which send outputs to the drivetrain. So you can drive it on pure electric or you can drive it on pure petrol or internal combustion. And the one assists the other, or should I say the petrol engine assists the electric motors to charge the batteries. And so don't confuse this with range extenders, though, such as the BMW i3 REX, which employs a petrol engine solely as a generator to charge the batteries. It doesn't actually drive the car. The propulsion is still pure electric on the BMW i3 REX. So that's another variation of a hybrid, but it's more of a range extender. And a true hybrid is integrating the electric motor and the petrol engine. And the setup allows the car to move on electric power only, petrol only, or a blend of both. What you will find in a hybrid vehicle, like we were talking about at the beginning of the show, is you will find that your fuel consumption is incredibly low. But don't be duped by that either. You know, it still costs to charge a car.
Yeah. Not much. But
exactly. No, it's a lot cheaper. Yeah. A lot cheaper. Yeah. But it's not for free, unless you've got solar panels.
On the car?
I think it's been tried.
I'm sure it has. I actually need to research that.
I think it has been tried. I think I've seen a few prototypes. And then finally, question number three, Wendy.
So this is actually a really good question. I have wondered this many times, so I'm happy that we're going to put this to bed.
Uh-huh.
But is petrol, or do the brands you buy from make a difference in the consumption or the quality of the fuel, rather?
Well, I mean, I suppose the long and the short of it is that the base fuel is the same. It's a brand agnostic. So whether you're buying from Caltex, whether you buy from BP, or whether you buy from Shell, the base product is the same. Okay, but I think there's a couple of things to consider, and that is different fuel companies add different additives to the fuel, which either they use as a USP to tell you that their fuel makes your car jets cleaner, makes your car run cleaner, has more lubricant in it, or whatever the case may be. So you know, there are some advantages or disadvantages to the different additives, and you know, you've just got to do the research yourself in terms of what those fuel companies are actually claiming. And then I suppose, you know, the faster this is just my own personal opinion, but the faster the fuel moves through the fuel tanks of the filling station, right, the cleaner the fuel in your car is going to be.
How do you measure that? Like, how would you?
You don't.
Would you? I was you about don't. To say, like.
Okay. So, as an example, you go out to, I don't know, flipping some town, 50 km from Oatsworn.
Yeah.
That's fuel stands in those tanks for a very long period of time.
Mm.
Okay. You can imagine that the fuel is less fresh. Now, I don't think you're going to get major complications with it because, the fuel's still moving through the tanks. But you can imagine when the faster the fuel moves through that filling station, the cleaner the fuel that's going to be in your car. So the fact that we fill up in urban areas, I don't think you've got too much to concern yourself about. It's kind of the same thing.
I've always believed, this is not product placement, but I've always believed that engine had, I don't know, I think it's because one,
You're thinking of the aesthetics.
Yeah, I like the color, and it just feels cleaner. It's bizarre, but that's always been my preference.
Well, I mean, it goes down to when you've washed your car, doesn't it feel like it drives better?
Yeah, definitely.
Exactly.
Definitely, yeah.
But it doesn't.
Yeah. Well, there it is. Yeah,
there you go.
There it is. Now we know.
And you know. I mean, the only other thing to add there is that you do get different kinds of diesel. You get a low sulfur diesel, and you get diesel with 100 parts per million sulfur, which, if you're going to put the dirty diesel, which is, the higher sulfur-based diesel into your car, your car is going to suffer the consequences of that sulfur if you have a diesel engine. Always look for the low sulfur pump. 50 parts per million, 10 parts per million, as low as you can go, put that kind of diesel in your car.
You
other
pay
than
a
that,
premium though, right? You do pay a little,
you
bit,
do pay a little bit of a premium for low sulfur diesel, yes.
Does it make a huge difference in the long term in terms of...
Yes, so the sulfur actually damages the workings of the engine over time, and you do get a negative impact with high sulfur-based fuels.
Well, there you have it, You learn something every time.
You learn something every time. But unfortunately, we are out of time. And that's been another show. Thank you, Wandy, for joining once again. And
such a pleasure. Best hour, well, best 30 minutes now of my day. So thank you.
Best 30 minutes of mine too. And that is Wandy Lisishi in the house. And my name is George Minnie. And it's been nice chatting again. See you next week.
Sounds good.